Hi, Lewis.
Thank you so much, Ron.
Yeah.
Appreciate you having me here.
No, thank you. Thank you. I got a lot to talk to you about. I mean, look, there's not a person probably on this planet, black, white, or otherwise, that doesn't know about BET. BET is just the driver of culture, you know, and it's the name is always, it's either Debra Lee, Bob Johnson first, of course, but you were the quiet force. I mean, Bob Johnson always, when he talks about his success, you know, right there, he talks about Lewis Carr. Can you just talk a little? What were you? I mean, that was like 30 something, 30 years ago almost, right?
When I met Bob in Chicago at the Marriott Hotel downtown, he may have had a vision for BET. I didn't. I was just interested in the job that he had at that particular time. And so interesting, Ron, that I turned that job down three times before I said yes. And
Whoa.
clearly, I had to be crazy. Because it has been an amazing run that
What
has
were you
given me so
doing
many
that was
gifts.
so important?
Well, at that particular time, I was working for Black Enterprise. I was working for Earl
Oh, that was yeah. That's
Grey.
an important gig. I love those
Right.
guys. That Graves family, a big important, you know, publishing family. So for sure.
Right. And who had heard of a BET
Right.
back then? All right. No one had heard of a BET, barely had heard of cable.
That's right.
So I was like, why do I want to take a risk like that? I think I'll stick around here at Black Enterprise. But Bob called me late one midnight after the third time, and he telling him no and said, I'm going to ask you one more time. And he said, I'm going to be successful with or without you, but I would rather be successful with you because I think you can bring great value to the vision that I am trying to achieve. And he said, I'll ask you this, make the best decision for Lewis and Lewis's family. And no one had ever told me that. They had just told me about how I could help them. No one had ever asked me to make a decision just about me and my family. So because he said that, I eventually said yes.
Talk about growing that. What did y'all have and not have at the beginning of that journey?
What we had was black culture at the beginning of that journey that had not been scaled across this country. We had the beginning of hip hop that had not been scaled across this country. As if you can remember the early 80s, Ron, it was really blacks to see themselves. They had to think about Fresh Prince and Different World. That was
That's
really the
it.
only
That's
sort of
it.
opportunities on TV for black people to see themselves on a consistent basis. So BET comes along, and they come along with music and movies and some sports. The whole black community and those people who love black culture were super excited about the opportunity to be able to turn on 24 hours a day and see themselves.
And within that, Lewis Carr was tasked to do what? And I'm sure it was different things at different points, correct?
Well, at initially, it was to, you know, sort of what I call, even today, is to educate corporate America on the value of black people. Now, we weren't as sophisticated back then as I am
Today.
today. So what we said, we sold corporate America on black people. But it really wasn't a sale, it was an education on black people and the value that they brought to this overall country. Yes, to quick service restaurants. Yes, to packaged goods companies. Yes, to travel industry. Yes, to politics. But at the end of the day, we wanted corporate America to understand that black people had real value and that could make a difference in their businesses.
What were the kinds of barriers maybe you ran into then and that you watched kind of come down and now the brothers walk in and do probably a sale? You laid that out for them though. you know?
Well, the barriers were, we're already reaching black people, Louis. You know, we
really?
We buy the NFL. We buy the NBA. We buy the NC2A. So we're already reaching black people.
Big numbers. Look how many black people watch
the Super Bowl. Yeah. So, and what I will say to him, oh, absolutely, you are reaching black people. But are you engaging black people? Mm. Are you influencing black people? Yes. Do they just look at you as a television show, or do they look at you as a brand? So, you know, we really had to go deep. We had to come up with, you know, insights and data to kind of show that, you know, black people were more engaged and more emotional about seeing themselves in a real black environment versus just as any environment.
In the movies, you know, they speed time along because things start growing really fast. You know, what was the sort of moment where you could say, like, wow, like, things are changing now?
When we saw networks like ABC and Fox and NBC start doing black shows.
So at this, all of this time, and this is where we're headed toward Waymaker Journal, you know, but so you're having this incredible success. You're driving the culture, you know, in media. You can feel it. It's becoming even mainstream now. The message that you are sending out about the importance of black people, people are developing content around that idea. You know, you're on the forefront of that growth. How was this changing you as a human being, you know?
Well, it helped me find my purpose, Ron. And it hit me like a ton of bricks, Ron. It came to me and said, I'm already in it. Mm. And what that was I was in a position to give black people an opportunity that they would not normally get in this industry. I mean, even today, this is not a real diverse industry, as you know. All right. So think about what it was back in the early 90s. All right. Really wasn't diverse. It was not diverse on television. It wasn't diverse behind the camera. It wasn't diverse in the business offices. It wasn't diverse in the sales office. But I had this unique opportunity to give people jobs that most other networks were not giving them. And I said, that is my purpose, to be able to give people opportunities. And I embraced it. And that's what was so special about that time.
Did you have a mentor around this? Someone, even when you were, you know, an athlete, you know, or is this your own just, you know, compulsion?
Everything that I didn't want to do in my life are the things I've been super successful in. Some of the things that I really didn't want to do, people convinced me to do it because they saw something in me, Ron, that I didn't see in myself. So when I look at my journey, and this is how we got to this brand, Waymaker,
yes.
I had people in my life who were waymakers, people who made a way for me when I didn't even know I needed a way. And they expected nothing in return.
Wow. I see. So the Waymaker is just an expression of gratitude that is converted into information for other people to like an on-ramp for them to grow.
Well, most people don't have professional headshots. Most people will never take a professional photograph in their life, all right? Especially now in the age of the iPhone. You know, most people just won't do that.
Right.
But what we realize over years, whether you are in entertainment or whether you are in school or whether you are in a business, people don't take the time and don't know the importance of having a great professional headshot. So we wanted young men and men not so young to have this opportunity to say, hey, I got a professional headshot. And Ron, I don't know if you can see it. You can see people, once they do it, how proud they are of themselves, how good they feel about themselves. Mm-hmm. You know, it's sort of like, you know, dressing up. You know, you when you put on a tuxedo, as they said, there's no bad looking guy in a tuxedo. You know?
No,
this
no,
is like
no.
There's no bad looking bride, you know, walking down the aisle. Every
That's
bride
right.
is beautiful.
That's absolutely.
That's what a headshot does for people. It gives them confidence. You know, it makes them feel good about themselves. Because the real purpose of the blueprint is to help people get knowledge and understanding so that when they walk out that door, they feel much better than when they walked in, no matter what level that they are. So one of the things we always talk about, we're going to meet people wherever they are. If you are 16 and 17, we're going to meet you wherever you are. If you're 25, we're going to meet you wherever you are. If you're 40, we're going to meet you wherever. That's why we have this broad spectrum of topics and speakers that come in, because everybody is different. Everybody's blueprint is different.
When I heard we had an opportunity, Detour, to meet with you and connect with you and build any kind of partnership, I just was like forward-leaning right off the bat, simply because I view travel as inspirational, you know, and transformational.
The opportunity to partner with you guys at Detour is very personal, very special to me. Because I know what travel has done for me. Mm-hmm. In the words of one of my clients, P&G, it widens the screen. Right?
Yes.
It gets you to look at life differently. It gets you to look at people differently. It gets you to look at different cultures differently. The first time I went to Paris, I was, number one, in awe of the city. As you know, it's one of the most beautiful cities in the world. Mm-hmm. I was in awe of the people. I was in awe of the culture. And then I had this emotion and I was mad at myself. That I had deprived myself for so long of so much information and knowledge. You know, it's sort of like, wow. Just to have conversations with people from different parts of the world and to understand how they think and their culture, I was just like, how could I have just been so deprived and so deficient? So I understand the importance of travel, and I understand the importance of doing it as early as you possibly can, because that feeds your appetite for the rest of your life and the things that you want to do or may not want to do. So that's why I was so excited about it.
Well, you know, I got to say, and I don't want to embarrass you, but you're like, you really, really have like your style, you know, I mean, your style, you know, is very, very, what would I say? It's chic, you know, and it looks global. You know, and it's super-
Ron, it came from that first trip. I never forget. I told my wife, we got back to the hotel. I said, even the taxi cab drivers wear good shoes. Did you see his shoes? And she was like, no.
I didn't see his shoes.
No, I was not. But Ron, I mean, you know, a taxi cab driver pick you up and he's got on a suit. You're going like, where you going? Where? All right.
That is so true. That's it.
I mean... And they're able to speak multiple languages. And, you know, they're asking you, you know, are you American? Are you from Jamaica? You know, and they're going through all of their Rolodex of languages. And you're going like, wow, yeah. Man, I got to up my game. This is not good.
Well, you know, you're a gem. You know, and I actually feel like I should have known what you were doing a long time ago. So if things happen when they're supposed to happen, you know, and I thank you for coming on the show today. And I look forward to our partnership. And so thank you, Lewis, for coming on today.
I appreciate it, Ron, and I look forward to the partnership and you guys helping us change the world.